So I'm giving this series of talks here in the Sangharakshita Memorial, well, I don't know if we call it Memorial Library, it's Sangharakshita Library. And in a way the talks centre around Bhante's teachings. And the way the talks came about was because I lived in India from the early 90s, working with the Buddhist community there, especially working with our own Buddhist community, Trilokya Bauda Mahasangha, as it was called then. And we had been in India since the late 70s, mostly Lokamitra working on his own. And then from the mid 80s, myself and Subhuti coming out, visiting once, twice a year, until in 94 I went out to live full time. And at that time, there were a number of criticisms which Trilokya Bauda Mahasangha was getting, that the teaching which was going on in TBMSG was not really in line with Dr. Ambedkar's own vision. That some people said it was maybe too Mahayana, maybe even it was tantric. Some people said it wasn't really in line with the Pali texts. They said all sorts of things. So I thought, well, really, we need to do something about that. We need to address the issues. And I wonder, well, what were the things that Bhante did teach that people might find unusual, that were quite characteristic of FW as it was then, or even Triratna, it's still characteristic of us now. What were the teachings that were characteristic of him, very special to just him and our movement, that perhaps others in India might not have heard about? So I got my pen out and I started a list, and before I knew it, I developed a list that I called Sangharakshita's Special Contributions to the Dharma. Now this was before Bhante's six distinctive emphasis list came out, and before the five pillars of the movement. So in a sense you'll find there's a bit of overlap and maybe even slightly different emphasis. So having chosen those distinctive contributions, I was invited to give a talk at the young girls' hostel in Pune, where we had, I think, about 60 or 70 young girls, but surrounding the girls' hostel was a community of women who helped run the hostel. So they were, you know, sometimes living close by, sometimes living as community members in the hostel. Plus, of course, there were also husbands, and there were fathers of the children, and so the audience sort of grew until there was about 150 people in the audience. And I gave the talks over 2 days. They were quite long talks, over 2 days. And then I was invited to give them again on another occasion, and I slightly changed them and gave them over 3 days. So now I'm going to give 3 talks today, tomorrow and the next day, which will cover 7 of Bhante's distinctive contributions. The 8th one I'm going to save. I'm going to leave it until the 14th of October, the anniversary date of Dr. Ambedkar's conversion to Buddhism, and give that as the launch talk, my launch. I don't know how many other launches we're going to have, how many people are going to speak, but that can be the topic for that day. And before I sort of launch into it, I just want to tell you that the two main books that I've, well, three actually, the three main books that I've always kept by me for reference with Dr. Ambedkar's work has been, of course, Bhante's Ambedkar and Buddhism, which is, I think, you know, invaluable, because what he draws out there, very few other people draw out in such a clear way. Very few. And then, of course, there's the life story of Dr. Ambedkar, Danaji Keir's, which I read just before I went to India the first time. And it's a bit flowery, it's a bit Indian style, but actually it's very readable. He's very thorough, he's usually fairly reliable, and my goodness, it really gives you an incredible impression of the man. Really, you know, quite outstanding. There are other biographies, I haven't read them. That was enough for me to get on with. And then, of course, of Dr. Ambedkar's own writings, I've always kept close by the Buddha and his Dhamma, which he had published just in the year that he died. He probably just finished it not long before he died. It may not be as he wished it to be, because the end sections of the book are much shorter than the beginning sections, and they're a bit more in note form. They're all a bit briefer, so we can imagine that probably he had the idea to expand it a bit more, and it was to be like the Buddhist Bible for his people. He takes a number of different approaches to Buddhism from other Buddhists, even from us. So that might come out in my talk as well. And then over the years, the volumes from the Ministry of External Affairs in Maharashtra have published the manuscript versions of all his writings, all his speeches, all his proposals to Parliament, all his essays, all his contributions to the newspapers and so on. Everything that they could find, they've tried to bring out in these editions. And I would suggest that rather than, you know, read much more by other people about Dr. Ambedkar, just go to what he's written. Take one of the books off the shelf there, open up at one of the interesting titles, and just have a look. He's a very, very good writer. Doesn't write in Indian English. It's more like Edwardian or Georgian English. It's very, very elegant and very precise, as you would expect from a lawyer, and as you would expect from somebody so highly educated in India. So I said that we were going to look at 8 special contributions. I'm going to give you the 7 just now. We'll deal with 3 today. And then tomorrow we'll give you the next 3. And then on the last day there'll be 1 topic and a bit more time to talk. And then the final topic, the 8th topic, will be on the 14th of October. So, no surprises. The first special contribution of Bhante to the Dharma as we see it, as we've been practicing it, his emphasis on going for refuge. It's not there in any other Buddhist group to the extent that we have it. I think every Buddhist group does have going for refuge. Tibetan groups, Chinese groups, Thai groups and so on. But as in the words of one Japanese friend of mine at Pune University, asking what was the main emphasis of Sangharakshita? And I said, well, the primacy of going for refuge. And he looked at me and said, well, just that. I mean, just the going for refuge. It's like he just didn't really see the significance of it at all. So that's the first one. Second one, the 24 nidanas. Of course, the 12 nidanas, you know, are in all Buddhist traditions, but the other 12 are not. So we're going to have a look at the 24 nidanas. And then today we're going to look at higher evolution. So that's our 3 topics for today. Higher evolution is just not there in any other group at all. Not in any format, as far as I can see. Unless they've had some contact with Sangharakshita. Tomorrow we'll deal with spiritual friendship and the individual. And then on the last day, we'll deal with right livelihood and art and the spiritual life. So those are my seven, and I've got reasons for putting them together in this particular way. You could do them in any other order, but this order seems to make some sense. The eighth one, you might get a prize if you can guess what it is.
Ambedkar.
Well, actually, yes, it is, but it's not one that I included here, and it's one that came to me after I came back to England. But in a way, I'll sum up at the very end of the eighth talk, and I'll say that, well, actually, there is a ninth one, and the ninth one is that nobody else really emphasizes Ambedkar's place in the Buddhist world and what he's done and what he's given to the Buddhist people. Nobody else except, of course, and this is why I didn't do it in India, all Buddhist groups in India recognize Ambedkar as being the most important, and they all emphasize it. But outside the Indian context, it's hardly there at all. And if it is there, it's not really the full significance. So I hope that that these talks will help us understand Dr. Ambedkar's significance a bit more fully. And the way I gave the talks originally are going to have to be slightly different from the way I'm going to do it now. In India, I wanted to point out the emphasis that Bhante had, and how it really was just an elaboration of the Buddha's own principles. So I looked at what the Buddha said, what Bhante said, and then how it enshrines the values of Dr. Ambedkar himself. Because I didn't have to say so much about Dr. Ambedkar while I was in India, because that was seen a bit more clearly, and many of us had given talks previously on that subject. But here, I have to turn things a little bit on their head, and I'll have to emphasise much more Dr. Ambedkar, and perhaps I'll have to emphasise less the actual teaching of Bhante on going for refuge or higher evolution, because you'll have done that. I'll just have to give it in a broad brush stroke, in a way, and point out also the connections to the Buddha's own approach. So I'll still keep the three same headings for each section. What the Buddha said, what Bhante said, Dr. Ambedkar's approach. So I wanted first of all to start with going for refuge, because this is one of the planks, if not maybe even the main plank, of Bhante's approach to the Dharma. And if you remember that when Bhante decided to start a Buddhist movement in the West, he decided, when he was in India, when he got the letter saying, please don't come back, we don't want you. And so he turned to his travelling companion, Terry de la Mer, and said, well, you realise what that means, don't you? It means a new Buddhist movement. And right from the beginning, he knew it would be a Buddhist movement based on going for refuge as the point of ordination. Not membership, not subscriptions, not signing any forms, nothing like that, which is what he'd seen in India before. He decided that his Sangha would have to be by commitment, that going for refuge would be the basis. Now that's nothing new to you, I'm sure. But let's go back a little bit further. Let's go back to the Buddha's own perspective. Let's go back to the time when there were only two refuges. Yeah? You remember that time? When there were only two refuges, not three?
There was no Sangha yet.
It was before your time, was it?
There was no Sangha yet.
There was no Sangha, yes. So the Buddha's in the jungle, isn't he? And he meets two men. And they have seen his footprints on the ground. And they've seen there's a Dhammachakra on each footprint. And they conclude, this must be something really unusual. And then they go and they find at the end of the footprints there's a holy man standing. And because the footprints were so unusual, they say, well, you know, are you a god? No, I'm not a god. Are you a Gandharva? No, I'm not a Gandharva. Are you, and they go through all the categories they can think of. And in the end, the Buddha says, well, I'm none of those. I'm the Tathagata. I'm the one who's gone forth, the one who's thus gone. And the two men, well, that's interesting. And then they move away. But then he meets two more men. Now, actually, it could be that in the suttas, it's actually one episode. Seems strange that he meets twice two different men. But in this occasion, he meets two men, and they recognize that he's quite extraordinary. And they ask him for teachings, and he gives them some teachings. And they say that for this moment onward, we go for refuge to you, the Buddha, and we go for refuge to your Dharma. And with that, they leave. Of course, there's no Sangha. There are no bhikshus, there are no lay people. So the two men, off they go, and apparently they're either, there's a sort of quarrel in Buddhist tradition, that they're either from Orissa or they're from Afghanistan. Nobody can quite decide what the original word refers to. But it seems that whether they were from one or the other, Buddhism flourished very early in both those places. And perhaps it had something to do with those two early men who went back home and spoke about this holy man that they met that was quite incredible. And soon others were coming to visit the Buddha from both the Afghanistan area and the Orissa area. So yes, there were two refuges, but that wasn't enough, of course. The Buddha himself very quickly teaches to his old five companions in the holy life, and one by one, each of them sees. Kondanya sees first with insight. Ah, he gets it. And the Buddha says, yes, Kondanya sees, Kondanya sees. So there's the first person who's really gone for refuge. Not just effectively, he's got insight. He can see clearly. And he's not going to fall back. And one by one, the others two gain insight and no doubt gain full enlightenment, according to tradition. And so there are five arahants in the world, plus the Buddha making six. So there's a Sangha. Afterwards, Yasha comes with his 500 young heroes, and Yasha wants to, well, I think he comes first of all on his own, if I remember rightly. He meets the Buddha and the Buddha teaches him. He goes for refuge. He goes for refuge to the Buddha, to the Dharma, and, of course, to the Sangha. And then Yasha's friends all come, and there are 500 of them. No, it's not 500, no. I think it's 50. It's 50 or so, that something that they come. They all go for refuge, and so there's a Sangha of round about 60 people. Around about that time, then the Buddha says, all of you go forth. Take the Dhamma, no two in the same direction, and teach for the wheel of the world. So from that point, the Dhamma really is spreading out. And when people go for refuge, they go for refuge to the three jewels. So that's the Buddha's approach, that you meet the Buddha or one of his disciples, you hear the Dhamma, you go for refuge to the Sangha, which usually, right at the very beginning, is comprised of quite a number of those who've got insight, once returners, non-returners, or even arahants. And from very early on, we can tell from the Pali texts, there are two ways the Buddha speaks of refuge. He speaks of a true refuge and a false refuge. And we can see this in the Dhammapada, that he speaks of false refuges are not caves, not hills, not trees. Those places where the local people would go and worship. They'd have a tree and they'd wind some thread round it and imagine there's a spirit in the tree, and they'd ask the tree, oh, protect us, you know. Or a stone that's a special shape. They'd colour the stone with sindoor, be beautiful and red, and they'd go for refuge to this stone. that's what they did, and that's what they do right down to today. You'll find that, you know, even special stones that are left over from road building, somebody will come and colour the stone red. Before you know it, it's got some flowers offered to it and some water sprinkled on it, some milk, some ghee, some yogurt, and so on. So those are not true refuges, as you can well imagine. But the true refuges are the Buddha, the Dhamma, Sangha, outside which truth will not be found. So that's the Buddha's approach to the three refuges, and you'll find all the way through the Pali texts that he speaks of people going for refuge to the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha, and encouraging people to go for refuge to the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha. And that gets enshrined in Sri Lankan Buddhism, well, Indian Buddhism, Sri Lankan Buddhism, Thai, Burma, China, Korea, Japan, Mongolia, Tibet, everywhere that there are Buddhists, and now in the West. But even though it's there, as I said, not many people really understand the distinction of what it really means to go for refuge and what it means to belong to a Buddhist community. And belonging to a Buddhist community very often means you join up, like a society. So if you join the World Fellowship of Buddhists, you have to pay a subscription. It's a club. It's a great club. Well, the youth section is. The older section is embroiled in politics very often. But yes, it's a club. And many of the other organisations are like that too. None of them ask you to go for refuge as the basis, which is rather sad. And what we saw in India, that the Mahabodhi Society, which Bhante was helping by contributing articles and later on by editing the journal of the Mahabodhi Society, it had got a reputation. And it had got a reputation even with Dr. Ambedkar. So that when Bhante first meets Dr. Ambedkar, Ambedkar says to Bhante, "Why have you got a Brahmin as your president of the Mahabodhi Society?" That's the first sort of question Babasaheb puts to Dr. Ambedkar, puts to Bhante. And Bhante says, "Well, first of all, I'm not a member of that society." And he sort of disclaims membership of the society because, yes, he can see that that many things in the society don't run according to Buddhist principles because it's run by Brahmins. Or it was then. So he never joined. He liked the Mahabodhi Journal. He contributed as much as he could. And in that way, the Buddhist teaching was communicated by him, you know, especially to a Buddhist audience. And also the Mahabodhi Journal went round the Buddhist world. So it had a large audience. So Dr. Ambedkar was, fair enough then. He accepted that. Dr. Ambedkar goes for refuge, finally becomes a Buddhist in 1956, the year he dies. And when he goes for refuge, when he converts to Buddhism, he does something quite unusual. And it's this that triggers in Bhante his first sort of idea that there's something more about going for refuge that he hadn't understood. So Dr. Ambedkar takes the refuges and precepts from Uchandramani, Bhante's own Buddhist teacher who'd converted him, who'd ordained him, I should say. And after Dr. Ambedkar's fully gone for refuge, he then turns round to the audience. And there's about 400,000 people there on that day. And in the presence of Uchandramani and other senior monks of the community, he gives the refuges and precepts to the community of monks, the community of lay people who were before him, who were Hindu, and who were treated as untouchable. He gives the refuges and precepts, and he follows the precepts by giving 22 vows, which were not there in the Buddhist tradition before. There were vows such as not to worship Brahma, not to worship Vishnu, not to worship Ganesh, not to worship Krishna, not to fall back into Hindu superstition, not to have anything to do with going back into the Hindu fold. He was really, really concerned that Hinduism shouldn't absorb back into its own fold this new emphasis on the Buddhist path forward for his people. Now, it's a big departure for Dr. Ambedkar to have done that, because in the presence of such senior monks, especially Uchandramani, the senior most monk in India, he's Burmese, but he lived in India for many years, to actually stand up in front of him and then give the refuges and precepts to others, as if he was as good as a Buddhist, good a Buddhist as Uchandramani, is a complete departure. Really, according to Buddhist tradition, he should have said, Uchandramani, you've converted me, now convert my followers. But Dr. Ambedkar realised that there had to be a statement made that going for refuge, whether you're a monk or a lay, means you're equally Buddhist. Doesn't matter if you've been a Buddhist for 20 years or 20 minutes, you're equally Buddhist. And he's equally able to therefore give the refuges to the lay people as Uchandramani would have been. Of course, he knew that his followers would have expected him to give the refuges and precepts. So that struck Bhante very, very strongly, that Babasaheb was making a statement that the refuges are primary. The number of precepts you take are quite secondary. And by giving the 22 vows to his followers, in a way he was giving a path to his followers of things to do, precepts to follow, asking them, you must be as serious in your practice as the monks are with their 256 monastic vows. So in a way he's saying, well, not only are you going for refuge and you're equally Buddhist to any monk that's been ordained, but also I'm expecting you to practice as seriously as the monks practice by giving these special vows particular to their situation. So, you know, that really sort of made Bhante think, and he mentions in his Ambedkar and Buddhism, and he mentions also in his History of My Going for Refuge, that's one of the steps on his road to realising the significance of the refuges and precepts. There were much more than he imagined, but he woke up fully that now there are more dimensions to this. And his understanding of going for refuge, it extends beyond that. After Dr. Ambedkar's conversion, he then reads the Dual Ornament of Liberation, translated by Gunther. And in the Dual Ornament, there's a whole chapter just on going for refuge, which he'd never seen before. None of the books had chapters on going for refuge. Tibetan Buddhism did. So then, you know, he began to investigate a bit further. Then he gives a series of talks in the West on the meaning of conversion in Buddhism, and the going for refuge being one of those ways of conversion. And he outlines in the late 70s the esoteric and the exoteric significance of the refuges. Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha, Lama, Yidam, Dakini, or Guru, Ishta Devata, and Dakini. And then he goes quite a bit further than that. In quite close succession, he then changes the name of the ordination that we had been receiving from the Upasaka ordination to the Dhammachari ordination. Dhammachari was not a specified category. It's a word that's there in the Pali texts, but there's nobody called, you know, well, this is a Dhammachari who's been ordained by a Dhammachari ordination ceremony. So the Upasaka ceremony, and I was ordained first of all as an Upasaka, we had a Dhammachakra on our Kesa, and we refer to ourselves as Upasaka, Suvajra in my case, and so on. But with being in India, we had to stand out. And our Buddhists, just looking like any other Buddhists, didn't stand out. If there were Buddhists from the Republican Party of India, they all wore blue. They wore a dark blue cap and had a Dhammachakra on their cap. If they belonged to another group, they'd have their own dress. So the Indian Buddhists, or Indian Upasakas, asked Bhante, could we wear our own specific dress? What would it be? And the suggestion was a blue shirt, and as well as the Kesa, so that it would stand out, it would stand out in crowds, and that we would be called, from that point onwards, Dhammacharis and Dhammacharinis. And so that was back in early 1981. So that was a sort of it was a statement in a way, and it was a statement that that the Indian Buddhists were making, which harks back to one of Bhante's very early articles that he gave to the Mahabodhi Journal. And the article was first article was wanted new type of Buddhist. And rather like Ambedkar's book is all divided into little sentences, each numbered. I think Bhante had a whole section on numbering, 1 to 20, something like that. Wanted, new type of Buddhist. The new Buddhist will not think, because he was an Upasaka, he has to practice less seriously than the Bhikshu. 2, I can't remember the order, but they're like that. To take the practice of Buddhism really seriously. Just because you're an Upasaka doesn't mean to say you just have to serve the monks. Doesn't mean to say you have to think of yourself just being a born Buddhist and that's enough. No. And that article was very, very well received. He went on and did another article a few months later called Wanted New Type of Bhikshu. And he really put the cat amongst the pigeons, as we say in English. He really stirred the pot, and people were sometimes very, very excited, angry with him, sometimes very thankful to him for having spoken out. So yes, the monks, you know, shouldn't indulge in stupid games like playing dice. Shouldn't just think that because they have a begging bowl, a robe, and a shaved head, that means the spiritual. That just because they're being served by the lay people doesn't mean to say that they're holy. So of course he was poking to the Buddhist community, monastic and lay, and he's never stopped since then doing it. And this Upasaka to Dhammachari really follows on from that. That he was expecting our Buddhist community in India to practice really seriously and to communicate the Dharma as fully as they possibly could. Very soon after that, we have Bhante's 6 levels of going for refuge. Sometimes in some talks it was 5, but quite often it's 6. The cultural going for refuge, provisional, effective, the point at which we try to get to for our own ordinations. Then with insight, the real going for refuge, and the absolute going for refuge. And following on from that, he then gives another talk, and this talk was given in India. It was given in 1982. It was given in Theosophy Hall in India to Madam Wadia. Unfortunately, her husband, Mr. Wadia, had died, and he was one of the main theosophists of India. But Madam Wadia, she was there and she hosted the talk, and it was given to both Ambedkarite Buddhists who had come with our Dhammacharis, with Bodhisen and Vajrasil and so on, and with Lokamitra, and also to the the intelligentsia of Bombay, who often went to these talks in the Theosophy Society. And the talk was centered around dimensions of going for refuge, which really was, you know, a very new departure in outlining the significance of going for refuge. That going for refuge itself represents the emotional and volitional aspect of the experience. The going forth represents the complete reorganization that's necessary regardless of whether you're a monk or a layperson. Opening the eye of truth, representing the insight of the unconditioned depths that's activated, in other words, the sort of cognitive dimension, the cognitive content of the experience of going for refuge. Fourthly, the entering the stream, which represents the breaking of the three fetters and the whole being flowing irreversibly towards Buddhahood, representing the sort of far-reaching and sort of permanent effects of going for refuge. And then lastly, the altruistic dimension of going for refuge, correlating with the arising of the bodhicitta, representing, as Bhante put it, the activation of energy for transformation of the world in accord with one's vision. So with those six levels of going for refuge and these five dimensions of going for refuge, let's have a look at Dr. Ambedkar. There's less to say here because, in a way, his approach was, like the Buddha's, very straightforward. But looking at his teaching, we can see that there are things that are very, very uppermost in Babasaheb's mind. He wanted a religion that people could commit themselves to body, speech and mind. And he says this from very early on when he's considering a religion to convert to. And he's considering, he says from 1937, that I was born a Hindu, but I will not die a Hindu. And that really rocked India for such a senior politician in India to have said such a thing, for a Hindu to have said such a thing was outrageous. But he says it, and he says that he will, because he's not going to die a Hindu, he will convert and he will encourage all his followers to convert. And he realizes that if they're going to convert, they have to convert, not just intellectually. Everything has to convert so that the whole of their beings, the whole of the community, is caught up in the conversion. So bodily means, well, especially ethics, especially their livelihood. That if they're going to convert, then really they can't think in terms of the morality that's necessary doesn't affect the way they organise their livelihood. They can't be involved in just the same old caste occupations which they've been assigned to, not paying attention to their own inspirations. In terms of speech, well, of course, the speech of the ex-untouchable community was quite rough, quite famed for being quite rough, because they've been relegated to the bottom of this of the heap. Separated from the intelligentsia, separated from education, separated from social intercourse. What was to be expected? They had quite rough speech. And in fact, Dr. Ambedkar himself, when he spoke in English, in his English talks, especially to Parliament, they were beautiful, they were eloquent, they were elegant. But when he spoke to his own people in Marathi, he'd use their own language, and he would tell them quite roughly, just what was what. He wouldn't mince words. He'd just tell them really directly in quite straightforward language, sometimes even quite peppery language. But he regarded that speech had to be affected too, that they couldn't just say, I'm a Buddhist, and leave it at that. It had to go further than that. and it had to affect their mind. He regarded that India had to be a democracy, and it was moving towards being a democracy, and it became a democracy in 1948 with its own leadership and its own elected parliament. And in the giving of the constitution, which he had the major hand in writing the constitution, he says to parliament, he introduced the constitution, it took hours and hours and hours to deliver it. But he said at one point, don't think that because we have a democratic constitution that we have a democracy. Democracy is a state of mind, and each of us has to cultivate it individually. And in a way, that's his approach also to his Buddhist followers, that they have to be Buddhists individually, cultivating high states of mind mentally, inside, experientially. He even speaks of them developing morality experientially, mentally, even developing democracy. He equates almost democracy in the highest sense with morality, and morality with Dhamma. So his conversion to Buddhism is not just going to be something just superficial. He's expecting his followers really to practice Buddhism. As I said, he himself gave the refuges to his followers, reminding the monks and the upasakas that there's no real hierarchy between them. They're equally Buddhist. The commitment was primary and the lifestyle was certainly secondary. And he gave the 22 vows, which should encapsulate the vision of them being a community which was going to provide a renaissance for really the real revitalization of India, and expects his followers to practice as seriously as the monks in their own community. And certainly, by the time Dr. Ambedkar converts, he already has in place ideas to bring about new Buddhist workers. He wanted a new Buddhist worker in the world. He thought the monks weren't capable of it. And certainly, the monks didn't really rise to the occasion, and haven't really since then. So, he has the Buddhist Society of India, he has a number of different organizations set up so that Buddhist workers could be trained. Unfortunately, those workers really should have been first and foremost his lieutenants, his senior lieutenants. But they themselves, I'm afraid, were not as rock solid as he wanted them to be. Even on the day of conversion, his lieutenants were trying to convince him to postpone his conversion. Postpone it until after the general election. Not today. Don't do it today. They were frightened. I'm pretty sure they were frightened of the kickback that was going to come. And in the end, Dr. Ambedkar got exasperated and said, "You do what you want. I'm converting today. And others will convert with me if they want. You do what you want." Well, of course, when it came to it, they were all on the stage behind him when he did his conversion. So they did convert. They should have been the ones that really should have taken forward the whole teaching of Buddhism and so on. They did conversion ceremonies, but I'm afraid really until Trilokya Bodh Mahasangha started up, we didn't really see spiritual teaching, Buddhist teaching, in the way that it should have been right from the very beginning. Just before Dr. Ambedkar's conversion, he's asked a number of questions by journalists. I was just reading some of them today, some of them are quite funny. Well, they're sad in a way, but yeah, they're humorous too when you sort of think of the situation. One of them he's asked, it's not funny, it's quite straightforward in a way, it's a very good question. which Buddhism are you going to convert to, Dr. Ambedkar? Are you going to convert to Hinayana or Mahayana? What will it be? And he said, he's not converting to any ism. He's just going to be a follower of the Buddha. And in a way, this again coincides with Bhante's own approach, that centrality of going for refuge is primary. And that's what gives us our relation between ourselves and other Buddhists and other groups. If they've gone for refuge, we've gone for refuge. We're all equally Buddhists. We relate to each other on the basis of our own spiritual master is the Buddha, our own spiritual values are the Sangha, the Dhamma, and the Buddha, of course. So there's a lot of connections really between Dr. Ambedkar's approach, that he really wants a renaissance in India. It's not just a renaissance in India either. He even says that unless there's a conversion of the world to Buddhism, there's no way forward. We're doomed. So there's the first of the three topics. In a way, I've given a bit more on this topic than I intend to give on any of the other topics, because the primacy of going for refuge is so important, and it's on this that, in a way, everything else is based.